Hello, podcast listeners. This is BB Nate. Thanks for listening to Tatooine Sons, a Star Wars podcast. It's so awesome to think that people enjoy what we do so much that they financially support us so we can do what we do. If you're not a Patreon supporter, please head on over to patreon.com/TatooineSons and watch our welcome video so you can learn more about how important it is for us to have your support. May the Force be with you.
This is Tatooine Sons, a proud member of the Star Wars Commonwealth Podcast Network. Be sure to listen to the galaxy's greatest Star Wars podcasts, including Talk Star Wars, Tumbling Sabers Podcast, Generation X-Wing, Rogue Squadrons Podcast, Skyhoppers Podcast, The Nerd Room, San Diego Sabers Radio Podcast, Less Than 12 Parsecs Podcast, and Retro Inc. Podcast. Visit StarWarsCommonwealth.com and take your first step into a larger world.
Welcome, Star Wars fans, to episode 51 of Tatooine Sons. There's a credible rumor floating around about the new Supreme Leader of the First Order and his choice of headwear. We'll try to figure out if we like this idea and what it means for Kylo Ren. Plus, we'll get ready for the winter finale of Star Wars Resistance, share our weekly hot takes, and read your reviews and tweets. Take that ridiculous thing off. It's time for Tatooine Sons.
It's true.
What is the name of the Porg on the Millennium Falcon?
The Force is strong in my family.
What do you think his name is? It's a big moment.
I am a Jedi, like my father before me.
Maybe Turbis?
Do or do not. There is no try.
Turbis? Pablo, if you're listening to this live stream, that Porg's name is now Turbis. It's a good Star Wars name.
We're not done yet.
These guys record an awesome podcast called Tatooine Sons. Everybody listen to it.
Welcome, Star Wars fans. This is Tatooine Sons, your weekly look into all things Star Wars. From the unique perspective of a father sharing his love for the amazing space fantasy saga with his two sons. I am BB Nate, and I am joined first by my brother, Samuel the Hutt.
Achoo to Star Wars fans. Thanks for tuning in. And, well, we know that there's a certain Star Wars fan who's also a Turbis fan.
There is a certain fan who's a Turbis fan. This was a fun morning, afternoon to discover. We'll talk about that in just a second.
And, of course, you can't have Star Wars without bizarre father figures. So, on that note, here's my dad, the Bowtie Jedi guy.
What's up, guys? Are you guys coming down at all off of the 50th episode, one-year anniversary interview with Steven Stanton and all the other fun stuff? You guys, have you kind of, like, had a chance to process yet?
Not really.
A little, though. Kind of tired, though.
Yeah, it's been a long day. We're recording on Thursday night, so I guess I should say happy Monday to most of you that are listening. You guys are most likely listening to this on Monday morning. You're driving to work. You're driving to school. You're sitting around the table. Maybe listening to it with your kids. Kids, you're listening to it with your parents so that they can get a little bit of Star Wars education from you. That's awesome. If you're a Patreon supporter, then you have access to this on Saturday morning. And so we'll say have a great weekend. From Tatooine Sons. But we're recording this on Thursday night. And so last week, we're going to come back to the Steven Stanton thing. Last week, you guys mentioned that after the interview that you weren't sure what you were going to think about, what you're thinking about it. It would take time to process. So we're going to start with you, BB Nate. Now that it's been basically a week since we had our Steven Stanton interview and our 50th episode and all the fun stuff with that. And if you haven't listened to it, just go back to last week's episode and check that out. BB Nate, what do you think? What's your response or reaction from all of that?
Well, I've had kind of a busy week doing school and all that stuff, so I haven't really had time to think about it. I'm just honored, mostly, that we got the opportunity to do that. And I mean, I don't really have much to say.
That's cool. What about you, Samuel? That?
Yeah, I mean, I'm with Nathan on that. It was a total honor and privilege for that to happen. But also, he gave us some pretty good insights. Now, I haven't had a chance to re-listen to the whole thing, because, like Nathan said, it's been a pretty busy week, and I've not been feeling well. But, yeah, I mean, from what I have listened to, it's really interesting, and he gives some really cool insights, especially to Obi-Wan, and then, I haven't had a chance to listen to it, but what I heard about Griff and all that, yeah. That was pretty...
If you're a Resistance fan, well, first of all, we'll talk, you know, about Resistance a little bit later in the podcast, but we did get our first ever dialogue line from Griff this last week.
And he was complaining.
And he was complaining, which is great. His name is Griff. It makes sense with it. But I really, when Steven starts talking about Griff and he says he kind of looks a lot like another character, you know, from Pre Vizsla.
The haircut.
Yeah, the haircut. And he starts talking about his past and his connection to maybe he's got an Imperial background or something like that.
We know he has an Imperial background.
Yeah, I think it's going to tie in big time to what we saw in Resistance this week. But we'll talk about that here in just a minute. All right, so let's talk a little bit about this Star Wars fan. All right, so here I am at work. I'm at my new job. You know, I'm plugging away. I'm literally in the middle of helping a contractor get signed up with our services and everything else. And I get a message on my phone from our buddy Patrick Covey. And he's he's like, you got to check out the last 5 minutes of the Collider podcast from today. Go on there. And he's like, you know, tells me to check it out. So as I finish up my sale and all that stuff, I pull up my YouTube account. And I look at it, and it's pretty awesome. So what you got to understand is that most of you listening to this, you know about Collider Jedi Council. It's one of the big boys when it comes to... Yeah, I mean, it's like...
They're the only other podcasts that we know of that got Steven Stanton on.
I think there may have been others, but that's true. They had him on the Collider Jedi Council. That's right. The weekend after Twin Sons aired.
Yep.
With that. And so Christian Harloff, who's the normal host of it, he was off this week. I don't know what was going on with that. But Ken Knapsack, who's a normal Kylo Ken Knapsack is what his nickname is on there. He was hosting, and they were getting ready to have a discussion about some buddy moments, like in team-up moments Episode 9, potential team-up moments. And they are reading questions from other Twitter followers and things like that. And they ask a question, and something very interesting happened. Listen here.
Final question today. This comes from Tamezkin. It has my name in it, so that's why I chose this question. But no, it kind of ties back to what we were talking about earlier with Rey and Rose, and I think we can continue into that. Any characters you hope to see cross paths in Episode 9 that haven't yet done so? I personally like to see Ben Solo Chewbacca interaction post-Uncle Chewie blasting him in the gut for this end of the sequel trilogy. That's why I actually really... like that idea, because Chewie's pretty upset, as he should be, but at one point you got to think little baby Ben was on Uncle Chewie's knee and they were talking about the world. It's sad and tragic. So we got, you know, Lando's coming back, Nine Numb still floating around. What kind of connections, not the big ones, the Ray and the Rose and all those kind of things, but little kind of fun things that you'd like to see, maybe even bring some surprise characters in?
Yeah. Well, you kind of put it together right there. Nine Numb and Lando, I want to see that reunion. You know, their time on the Millennium Falcon. Are we going to get that?
It's a great question of if Lando was to go back on the Falcon,
I want to see
who's his co-pilot?
Yes, I want to see at least that, you know, like when Luke came on the Falcon in Last Jedi,
great.
I couldn't stop the chills.
Yeah.
I was like,
oh, you might have had the flu, but yes, also.
great moment. Of this.
Great so, moment.
Yeah, you know.
But, yeah.
Third chapter of a trilogy. That, you know, Lando and Nine Numb, that would be great
Lando,
to see.
Lando rushes into the Falcon cockpit. He sits down, and then the chair's empty. And then all of a sudden, you know, Nine Numb and Chewie come in. They're, like, trying to get to the door at the same time.
And then shotgun.
Sit down. Shotgun. And Chewie sits down. And then, like, Turbis the Porg hops up.
Yeah, like, right. Its name's Turbis?
Well, there is a podcast called Tatooine Sons. A father and his two young sons have this podcast. And I've met them before. It's come a villainy. They're really nice folks. They were at, I think, the Collider Q&A with Rian Johnson, and they said it. They said, well, we've named him Turbis. And so Rian Johnson says, that's great. I want that to be canon. Pablo, make it, if you're listening, make it canon. So it's not official, but
okay, I, love
I
that,
kind
though.
Of like the idea of Turbis being his name. That's anyways, great. Kim.
Wow, what just happened? All right, so here's the context, okay? Let's see. I started listening off and on to Star Wars podcasts 3 or 4 years ago. Probably 3 years ago, I guess. About a, actually, if I remember, it was during Star Wars Celebration 2016 that I started listening to Star Wars podcasts. And the very first Star Wars podcast that I ever listened to was Collider Jedi Council.
Really?
And they were talking about Star Wars Celebration 2016, and they were talking about the Chewie moment, Han, we're home, or Han saying, Chewie, we're home, that whole thing. It was awesome. And so, for today, for us to get this, you know, kind of like little tiny shout out on this beast of a Star Wars podcast was a real treat for us to start season two. What's really interesting, guys, I haven't told you guys this. So I've been like writing out plans for this season, the things that we want to accomplish in this year. And one of the things I put on there was that I would like I've got like very reachable goals, and then I've got like crazy out of the box, like there's no way they're going to happen goals, because we've had crazy out of the box, there's no way they're going to happen things happen to us in the last
entire first year.
So literally before I'm like writing them on a notepad while I'm working today, and then it was like 30-45 minutes before I get this text, I wrote something down.
I got a bad feeling about this.
I wrote down that I would, what if we could get one of us to be a special guest guest on Collider Jedi Council? And then this happened.
Yeah.
I mean, that's pretty cool. So what do you guys think? What did you think about it when you saw it? So I text the mom, because Sam and Nathan were, you know, doing other stuff, and they were running around. And I was at work, and I wanted her to record it. And so she videotaped it so I could see it. But I wanted... what did you guys think when you saw the video? Because I had you guys watch it. BB Nate, what did you think?
I don't know, because I'm like, hey, maybe it's a title, episode 9 title release or some footage. And I'm like, wait, we would have already heard about that. So I'm like, hey, maybe it's something about Turbis the Porg. And then I found out, and I'm like, hey, that's really cool.
That was awesome.
Somebody that big actually recognized the name for the Porg being Turbis. And so that was a little bit of a surreal experience.
Yeah, especially because you guys met him, like he said on the video, you guys met him at Scum and Villainy Cantina when Star Wars Explained, Molly and Alex invited us to participate in that little meetup that they did at Scum and Villainy. We met him and his co-host from his own podcast that he talks Star Wars on, the Force Center podcast, Joseph Scrimshaw. So we met both of them, and they gave us some advice about podcasting, and, and they were super genuine and super gracious. You know, they were there to hang out with friends. They were there to drink some adult libations and not talk to kids and like fanboys like us, but they were really gracious and they were awesome to us. So that was cool. What did you think about it, Samuel?
I mean, I kind of went through the same process as Nate. You know, I was like, well, it can't be a huge episode 9 announcement because I was scrolling through Facebook. I would have seen something. And then I thought, well, maybe it is something with Turbis, but I wasn't sure. So yeah, watching it, and he said, and then Turbis the Poor comes up. I think Nathan said that it's like he didn't even like hesitate. Like,
no,
he knew. He recognized 100% that the name of the Porg is Turbis. You know.
Yeah. His belief is that Porg's name is Turbis, and there's no doubt in his mind.
Yeah, that's awesome.
That is so crazy. Cool.
And then the little shout out he gave us was cool.
Oh yeah. You know, I mean, and this is awesome for us because obviously, if nothing else, there are going to be tens of thousands. I mean, this is a big podcast. Tens of thousands of people that listen to this that have never heard of Tatooine Sons, that have never heard of Turbis the Porg, that have never heard that story, that now have heard it because of this, which is a big shout out as we continue our push to make Turbis canon. So we'll continue to do that. All right, we've got some cool stuff happening. I just want to send a couple shout outs to our Patreon supporters. You guys are absolutely awesome. Thank you guys for all of your support. And we have some new Patreon supporters. After the podcast last week, one of our buddies from the Star Wars Commonwealth, he's one of the co-hosts of Tumbling Saber podcast, Carlos Candido. Carlos, he's a great musician, by the way. He's on Patreon as well. I highly encourage you to go check out his Patreon page. He's got some videos of his music and him singing and songs he's written and the guitar stuff. If I'm not mistaken, he actually plays the Star Wars theme on an acoustic guitar as the intro for Tumbling Saber's podcast. Oh, and wow. It's absolutely awesome. Carlos, and he's hilarious on that show. But he's got kids, boys like us, or like you guys, and he loves this podcast. And so he signed up at the $5 level last week. That was awesome. And then Grammy, she had a little bit of a problem trying to get it set up, but eventually she did. She increased her support from a $10 level to the $25 level on that. So that was awesome. We have another new supporter at the $1 level, which you get access to all of our special Patreon exclusive podcasts and videos and things that we're going to be doing over the next year. That's Eric McGilvray. I believe he's in Australia, by the way. Uh-huh. And literally, as I was playing the clip from Ken Knapsack, I got a notification on my phone that we had another new Patreon supporter. And she, Emily Hoffman, thank you so much, Emily. She signed up at the $10 level, which is an important level. That is our Sticker of the Month Club level. So that will be a nice little segue into what's going on with the Sticker of the Month. So starting in January, we're going to be releasing Sticker of the Month and T-shirt of the Month. Sticker of the Month Club members are those at our $10 level and above, and T-shirt of the Month participants are those at the $50 a month or higher levels. And it's simple. The theme for January, we'll be doing a special Patreon-only podcast episode as we explore the theme of hope. And hope is a big deal in Star Wars. It's funny, there's been this big, long conversation all day long on Twitter today about what the name of Episode 9 is going to be, and lots of theories, and almost probably well over half, maybe 75% of them have had the word hope in it. Hope is such a critical theme. I want to go on record today being, what's the date today? December 6th, as we record this. I want to go on record and say that we had already planned on January being our theme being hope before any potential title announcement comes out. If they came out with it in December and it happened to have hope, we had already been going down that path. Just want to go on record with that. And so she's going to get that. We're going to be doing some special things. I'm going to be reaching out to some other content creators from the Commonwealth, some of our Patreon supporters, and some other YouTubers and podcasters, and asking them to potentially see if I can get them to send in clips like they did for our anniversary, where they talk about how Star Wars inspires hope for them. And we'll talk about those on that episode as well. So we're really excited about that. You can get in on all of this Patreon exclusive content by just signing up for the $1 a month level. We've got a special gift that's going out in December for everybody that gets signed up, I think before Saturday or Sunday, because we're trying to get it all pulled together with that. So by the time you hear this podcast, if you're not a Patreon supporter already, it may be too late. So, but try to get signed up at the dollar level or more. We are pushing to our next goal. Our next goal is to try to get to $250 a month in support. When we do that, we are going to record a commentary of us watching and giving our comments on the Maul arc from Star Wars Rebels. So all the Maul episodes. And so we'll break them up. Actually, the commentary will be broken up into each episode so that you can sync it up and watch that episode with our commentary, because, of course, you guys want to hear what we have to say about that. You know, we did that with the finale, where we watched those finale episodes, the last two episodes of Star Wars Rebels. We watched those live on YouTube Live, and it's had thousands of views.
Yeah, it went crazy.
It's like,
big
for us, I mean, at least, you know, it's in the thousands, both of those on that. People loved watching us watch Star Wars Rebels because it's how, you know, we came together as father and sons around Star Wars. So we're going to be doing that. And then also, here's the deal. For all of you that sign up before January 1st, so by the end of this month, by December 31st, we're going to have a special contest, and we're going to pick one of our new Patreon supporters to receive a special Turbis the Porg mug. And so that will be our little gift for to encouraging you guys a little extra to do that. So are we ready? You know, it's 20 minutes into the podcast, and we're still on our banter section. So let's keep going. Let's talk about some reviews from last week. We had two new reviews. We had Jen Hoff. I don't know if that's like General Hoff or whatever. But Jen Hoff gave us 5 stars. Thank you very, very much. And their review was, love this podcast. My Star Wars loving daughters got me interested in this podcast. Aww. And we love it. That is awesome to think that some daughters got a parent listening to this with that. All right. And then, of course, our buddy that's our new Patreon supporter at the $5 level. Jedi Knight is what I believe that level is.
$5
mm-hmm. level. Mm-hmm. Carlos Candido, which we just got done talking about. He gave us a review on iTunes Canada, which we're now able, because of this new website that I found, I'm able to find all the different reviews from all the different countries now, nice. Which is nice because we haven't been able to have that. High fives. Obviously, 5 stars with that. I love this show. Appointment listening. Do yourself a favor and subscribe today. That's pretty awesome.
Cool.
Awesome. All right, let's go to last week's. Do we have a theme for podcast poll of the week? We usually do, don't we?
I believe so.
Yep, there we go. So this is, here's the results for actually from 2 weeks ago, because we didn't do podcast
poll last week. Oh, that's right.
These are the results from 2 weeks ago, podcast poll of the week.
Are you brainless?
I never ask that question till after I've done it.
What? No!
Every single week, the three of us do the no with Darth Vader. Every single week. All right. Last 2 weeks ago, podcast poll of the week was, because we talked that episode about Ben Solo's redemption.
True.
Right? If Ben Solo is redeemed, who will be the one to bring him back? Wasn't as big of a poll. Mark Hamill didn't tweet in there. We didn't have Ryan Johnson comment on it. So we have 413 votes, which was awesome. We have 4 choices. Rey, Luke, Leia, or other, comment below. And I know you guys have seen the results. Have you looked at them?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
No? You have?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Well, BB-8, you haven't?
I have.
Oh, you have. Okay. Well, then I'll just tell them.
We plan ahead.
I was going to ask you to guess, but now we're just going to move forward.
I think that Ray won.
Yeah, like with 54% of the vote, well over half of the vote on that. That makes sense. I mean, the idea of Ray and Raylo and Ben and all that kind of stuff, that's a big part of it. Second place on that was Leia, which I think is a reasonable thing. I think that we see in Force Awakens and then we see again in The Last Jedi that Ben's frustration with his family and his like his hatred in some ways for his family is also he's conflicted with a love. Like he's what he says when The Force Awakens with Han, but then also how he's like has the opportunity to attack Leia and doesn't in The Last Jedi. So I can see where people would come up with that. In 12% for other, comment below with that. So we'll come and we'll read a few comments about that. And then 8% said Luke. And so there's not a lot of idea for Luke. I think that the whole see you around kid thing, that kind of sealed the deal for it.
And it'd be kind of difficult to like redeem someone after you tried to kill him.
He didn't try to kill him. All right, let's.
Well, it sure seems like that from Kylo's perspective, though.
Kylo probably thinks that absolutely. We know that. That's the way Kylo's version of the story
was. So it'd be kind of tough to trust him.
It reminds me of that verse that we read in our reading today, because we read the Bible like on the same Bible plan, mm-hmm. all four of us in the family do, every morning. And we were reading through Proverbs, and it was talking about how when, you know, one version of the story basically seems right until you hear the other version of the story, the other person's side of the story. It's right. Kind of that scenario. It reminded me of that, honestly, because I think about Star Wars altogether way too much in my life. Okay. so let's go through some of these. So we got 3 comments we're going to read. Who's going first?
I will.
All right, go see.
And this is from Star Wars Command Center. And you should follow them. They're pretty cool, right? You would know better than me because I'm not.
They're awesome. Twitter, yeah, you guys stay off Twitter. But.
Yeah. All right, he says, Han couldn't, Luke couldn't, and Rey couldn't, but Leia can.
I like that idea.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think about that, BB Nate?
I agree. I think that they've all tried. All of those characters have tried, except for Leia. And we see that Kylo.
Kylo?
I'm Kylo? Thinking of Kylo.
You've been having a tough time tonight.
I have been tired.
Yes.
Have tough time.
It's recording after school that always, you know, yeah. In the evening after school that your brain's already fried, right?
So I think that, and Kylo didn't kill
Leia,
and he's tried to kill Luke. He killed Han.
He did kill and Han, yeah.
Almost tried to kill Rey.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, I agree. You know, she even said in The Force Awakens that there's still light in him. You know, she has hope for him.
Yeah, but then she loses that hope at the end of The Last Jedi and says, you know, what she says about him not being able to come back. But that's when Luke says, no one's ever lost him or something. And then Luke says, no one's ever truly gone. So.
I think that she would probably be the best character to redeem him. But it's technically, it's difficult because Carrie Fisher's no longer with us. And they've only got a limited amount of footage to use. So, I don't know where they can go with that. Although, I think that she would probably be the best character to do that with. Unless they did Chewie somehow.
Yeah, a lot of people have suggested Lando or that type of thing as well. But what do you what's the next tweet there, BB Nate?
Galatians 4:6.
That's an interesting Twitter handle. Okay. Galatians_4_6. But anyway.
Okay. I believe they're really the two halves of that one whole. Anakin will return to stir him to realize his folly.
Yeah.
But Rey will give him the reason / courage to take the pivotal step.
Yeah, what do you think about that, Sam?
You know, I don't know.
Will we see Force Ghost Anakin? Will Grandpa come back to speak to Kylo Ren and Ben Solo about... the past.
I threw this idea out one podcast. I still really like the idea of either two ways it could happen. I imagine seeing Kylo in his chambers. On one side of the room is Vader's mask, and on the other side of the room is I don't know. Maybe he gets it somehow from Rey, or is part or all the whole of Anakin's lightsaber. Right? You got both. Both sides of Anakin, right? The good and the bad. And either you see a force ghost of Vader and a force ghost of Anakin manifested near each object, because it's not unlike Sith ghosts to appear near an object. That's Darth Bane in Clone Wars.
Or you just this hear, Lord Moment, that's from the comics. Yeah.
Or you just hear voices from each one, and they kind of do this cool, like, intercutting.
Like, we're not even sure if it's just Kylo Ren giving into insanity or something like that.
You know, something like that. And he's having this argument, and he's being pulled by Anakin to the light side, and then pulled by Darth Vader to the dark side. And there's just this intense moment. I would love to see that. Whether it's a force ghost or a voice or anything. I mean, I feel like that would be a really intense scene. I would really like to see that. So, yeah, I mean, I could see Anakin playing into that in a way. I just think it, you know, it'd be best done in my headcanon version.
Yeah, that's awesome. What do you think about that idea of Anakin coming back?
Well, I'm hoping that Anakin comes back. I think that they should, for closing off the series, and it's all been about Anakin, and he was the one that started it, so...
That's true.
He should be able to come back in the last movie. I'm not 100% sure if it's Anakin or Rey that's going to redeem him, if not both. I don't think that that would be a really good idea. But, hey, if that does happen, I won't be...
What, you're not going to, like, your childhood's not going to be dead?
Whoa. No.
Okay, well, that's good. All right, and then the last Twitter comment from... And we had quite a few. Some of them...
not so friendly?
We're not going to read them online on the podcast. But anyway, Coruscant Radio Underground, another fellow podcast, I believe.
Let's go with it.
Yeah. Kylo redeems Kylo. He has to make that decision, just like Vader had to make that decision. Luke was the catalyst, but he did not redeem Vader. That being said, from what we've seen so far of Kylo, his mother is his weakness. Leia's death could serve as a catalyst that leads Kylo back to the light. So, Coruscant Radio Underground's basic premise is Vader redeemed himself. The catalyst was Luke. Kylo Ren will have to redeem himself. This time the catalyst will be Leia. Go for it, guys. Which...
Well, Leia will die and Kylo will turn to the light is what I'm thinking.
Okay.
I think, like I just stated that I think Leia would be the best move, but technically it's difficult. I think that if using this logic, you kill off Leia in a way, which sounds bad, but you know, you end her character in a certain way that it could be the catalyst to redeem Kylo. I think that that would be the easiest. I don't know how they'll do it technically. Maybe they have Leia on a ship or something and it gets blown up or something to that effect. But I think that that would be a, I mean, I would imagine it'd be a really strong catalyst for Kylo. I mean, he would have lost his father. Now his mother. I think that would be pretty jarring. And if he's already had some, I mean, he's stated that he feels, it was in The Force Awakens, but he talks about feeling like pulled to the light. I think that if that pull is magnified a little bit in the early stages of the movie and then his mother dies, I think that might be the final push
to
the light side. Yeah.
Okay, what do you think, BB Nate? You were raising your hand.
Well, I mean, he already killed his father, and then when Leia dies, I think he kind of would figure out kind of what Anakin says, what have I done? That kind of thing. With none of his... no parents left, I think he'll just... either, like Sammy said, it may push him to the light side, or it will just push him further into the dark.
That's what I think would happen in that.
It's either...
there's nothing left to live for on the light side.
It's either one way to go, or...
yeah.
It's sort of like what you said, how Anakin was like, what have I done? You know, he's basically, like, so distraught at what he has just done that he has to give in at this point. There's no turning back. Yeah. Maybe that's what Kylo thinks.
My general belief about redemption as a concept is that one cannot redeem himself. The idea is, it is, you know, let's just be really transparent. It's a biblical concept when we're dealing with it in contexts of like individuals and their souls and their good and evil and things like that. And it goes all the way back to the Israelite slaves in Egypt that were redeemed is what the Bible says. And so they were redeemed. That was like being purchased out of their slavery. And so the idea is Kylo Ren can't redeem himself. And so I think there has to be somebody that's involved. That's more than just a catalyst, but someone that does that. That's why I keep feeling like I keep getting down this path, and I'm probably going to be wrong. And there's a lot of people that want me to be wrong about this, but I've got the feeling that a beautiful ending to this story would be if Rey gives her life to save Ben Solo and bring him back. That is a redemption, classic example of redemption.
Now, do you think that for that to be able to happen, for, you know, Kylo to be redeemed by Rey's sacrifice, do you think that his Leia has to die before some time previously in the movie for it to accomplish its goal, Rey's goal?
Yeah, I don't know if it's even... I haven't even thought it through from that perspective. I don't think it really matters necessarily.
Okay.
With that. So, all right, that's it for the podcast. Well, let's talk about something else.
Yeah. So it's been 2 weeks since we discussed Resistance, and a lot has happened. We finally learned about what happened to Yeager's family, and there's been a huge revelation about Captain Doza. It's all leading us to the winter finale coming this Sunday evening. Strap on your helmet and get ready to talk about Star Wars Resistance.
We have a mission for you.
But I was going into Tosche Station to pick up some power converters.
How do we blow it up? There's always a way to do that.
Droid, please.
Light it up.
All right, so 2 weeks ago, the episode was called The Platform Classic, and the synopsis goes like this. It says, and in an attempt to I'm going to start over here.
Go for it.
In an attempt to boost the Colossus's economy, Captain Doza invites Yeager's estranged younger brother and renowned racer Marcus Speedstar to the Platform Classic. Still bitter at Speedstar for causing the deaths of his wife and daughter during a racing accident 10 years ago, Yeager refuses to speak with Speedstar. Despite the high life, Speedstar still struggles with paying his debts to the Guavian Death Gang, who kidnapped his mechanic Oplock. Yeager's attempt to force Speedstar to pull out of the race backfires, and Yeager is compelled to participate in the Platform Classic. At the urging of both Speedstar and Kaz, Yeager decides to forgive his younger brother and allow Speedstar to win the race. After paying Speedstar's debts to the Guavians and freeing Oplock, the two brothers reconcile before parting ways. So I gotta ask, what's hot and what's not?
Yeah, we'll do the what's next for on the next episode because we already know what happens right. next. All
so right. so what did you like from this episode?
Who goes first? You go first, I go first. Who goes first? I don't have that sound effect on here.
Nate, how about you go first?
So what did I like? It was a different episode. Not like I enjoyed the episode, but it was more for Dad because his thing is Yeager.
I like Yeager.
And I thought it was a good episode. It brought some backstory. Sometimes these 20-minute things, if they're trying to push a really emotional, powerful backstory into the thing with in 22 minutes, normally it feels rushed and not explained well. But this one, I think it really did well for what it was doing. So I thought that was a good episode, and I didn't have much to say about it.
Okay. What about you, Deb?
Yeah, I liked it. Obviously, I've been waiting for, like, since the episode, first episode, when I said that Yeager was my guy on this one. I've been waiting to hear this, and then when we saw, I think it was in this third episode, when we saw the photo of Yeager with his family at Batuu, mm-hmm. I wanted to know what happened to his family. I thought we were going to find out that somehow the First Order was involved in the death of his family. And I was surprised in a major way to find out that Marcus is his own Yeager's own brother. His desire to cheat to win a race and beat his brother resulted in an accident that caused multiple deaths, including the death of Yeager's family. And so I think there's an interesting dynamic about rivalry between brothers. With that, so
I got a bad feeling about this.
You guys have tended to not have those types of sibling rivalries, and I
because we all know I'm better, so
yeah, anyway. All right, hold on.
Impressive, every word in that sentence was wrong,
yeah. So, you walked into that one, but yeah, so, I loved this episode. I actually got the opportunity to go on the Star Wars Underworld, their resistance episode podcast with Dominic Jones and talk the whole time.
Kazudacast?
No, I don't think that happens.
I thought that was their resistance episode.
Yeah, I don't remember which one it is, but they've got so many different podcasts. I can't keep up with Star Wars Underworld's podcast, but that was an awesome episode to be on, and we talked all about it. So I loved this episode.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, it's probably my favorite episode so far, just because it well, we got flying again. That was nice, you know, in a show that's all about flying. But,
yeah. The racing scenes were stunning.
Yeah,
The graphics, the colors, the all of that. It was some of the most beautiful animation I've ever seen.
Yeah, and the race was cool, too, because they literally would climb up as fast as they could till they hit this certain ring. They'd stall out. And then they'd fall back down, and they had to make it into a certain ring, otherwise their engines wouldn't restart, and they'd crash.
Yeah.
It was crazy, but
we got to see a little Griff Halloran
in his little. Racing.
It still hadn't heard him say any lines yet.
He plays dirty, though. He was shooting. No. I guess that's not against the rules, though.
Hey, you gotta do what you gotta
do.
Right.
Racing aside, the revelation that it was Yeager's brother that killed his family was a total blindside.
Yeah.
I found that totally, like, I don't know the word. I can't think of the word right now. But it totally threw me off guard. Because I was expecting, like you said, First Order or something, you know, like, tragic like that. But his own brother, I mean, that was crazy. And then, you know, at the end he says, so are we good? And Yeager says, no. But we'll get there one day, maybe. Or something to that effect.
Yeah, no, but we will be, is what I said.
I'm glad how it wasn't all, like, happy.
Yeah, it wasn't a Cosby Show episode,
right?
Or something like
that.
You know? What did you think about that ending, BB Nate? You know, when there was this moment, Yeager, obviously he cares about his brother still, and he pays off his debts so that we can get
Oplock.
His mechanic, yeah. Back from the Guavian Death Gate, which was that was awesome too. Having those guys in there was cool. But then he asks him, are we better? And Yeager says, no, we're not, but we will be. What did you think about that?
Well, I mean, I was expecting him to say, yeah, sure, we're all good. But when I actually thought the ending was a little bit better when he said, no, we're not, but we will be. Yeah. I thought that Yeager is a really, he may not be Yoda wise, but he is wise. And so I thought that I was a good ending for the story and
yeah.
Happy that, I mean, I would have loved to see Han Solo race against Yeager.
Yeah, let's talk about that, because there was some Han Solo little moments, at least from a perspective of a Han Solo fan, like I am, with this. There's a couple moments. Obviously, we find out that Marcus Speedstar has previously won the five sabers, which that has a connection to Han Solo because of the racing stories from Bloodlines, mm-hmm. and he's won the five sabers himself. So that was interesting. I guess my question is, do you think that there's like throwing these little tidbits, these little Easter eggs or whatever out there in preparation for bringing Han Solo in some point in the future? Go.
Yeah, I mean, we've been hearing rumors for a while that Han Solo would eventually make an appearance in this series. And them throwing in all these Easter eggs and little hints and stuff would almost support those claims. Now, I'm not sure if it's going to be winter finale or even this season. But yeah, I think that being so close to The Force Awakens and the nature of the show, I think we will eventually see Han Solo. Now, do you think it'll be voiced by Harrison Ford, or do you think
he's... Well, that would be the ultimate for this, wouldn't it?
I don't think he'll do it, though, because, you know, it's Harrison Ford, and that's just not his thing. But
that would be pretty awesome. Be cool.
What about you,
Nick? Maybe they'll have Mark Hamill pretending to be
Harrison Ford. What was that, the bad lip reading?
Bad lip reading, yeah.
Yeah, the... which one was it?
It was The Force Awakens.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. He does an amazing Harrison Ford, so that was pretty cool. Do you think we're going to see Han Solo's BB Nick?
I don't think it'll be this little half season, but I think maybe, I don't know. I don't know if they'll put Han Solo into here.
Well, here's the challenge that I think we're running into with this, is they've seemed to be telling everybody that things were going to overlap with The Force Awakens and The Last Jedi. And so if they're going to be bringing the series to The Force Awakens, we better see Han pretty quick, because he doesn't make it out of The Force Awakens alive. And
well, you want the bad news or the really bad news?
Yeah, exactly. So, we'll see about that. What about also the moment in the cantina when Marcus Speedstar gets approached by the Guavian Death Gang and all this other stuff? It felt to me like a Han Solo versus with Greedo moment being played out all over again. What did you guys think about?
Yeah, he did. He was like, oh, wait, that was your guys' ship? Oh, man, I'm so sorry. I didn't know that, you know?
Yeah.
Talking his way out of it.
Yeah, it felt a lot like it. What did you think about that scene?
Well, the Guavian Death Gang kind of was a little bit more forceful in their approach, rather than Greedo.
Well, Greedo was going to kill him.
They didn't force him to win the race, give him credits, or he'll kill his best friend. Yeah. So yeah. I think that would be a little bit worse than me dying, because I wouldn't be able to think about it.
All right. So what did you not like in this episode?
There's not much for me that I didn't like about this episode. There's not much in the series that I don't like. I mean, it's a great series. I don't think that anything's wrong with it so far. I'm thinking that sometimes it's going to have its problems, but I haven't seen much yet, so I'm just waiting for what's not to be coming.
Okay.
So
I guess my only real criticism was that during the race, we see Marcus and Yeager so much better racing than the Aces. And I know that they let us know that they were going to be. You know, Marcus Speedstar is this massive superstar in the racing circuit. And Yeager's better than him. He's never beaten Yeager, is what we find out. So we know that. But the Aces are the Aces. And they're the ones that are supposed to be like the center, one of the central elements of the show. And the best racers and all this other stuff. And other than Griff trying to cheat his way to victory, there wasn't much challenge from the racers. So I want to see the racers become a little bit more refined. Just like I've said in the past, I want to see Kaz, stop being a bumbling kind of mess and be, the Republic pilot that I know he is. So.
Yeah. So let's talk about last week's episode, and its title goes Secrets and Holograms. Its synopsis says, tired of being cooped up inside the luxurious Doza Tower, Captain Doza's daughter, Tora Doza, sneaks out of the tower. She encounters Kaz and BB-8, who are seeking information on Captain Doza's connections with the First Order. In the marketplace, Tora encounters growing public dissatisfaction with her father's leadership on the Colossus. While the First Order's emissary, Commander Pyre, negotiates an agreement with Captain Doza, Kaz befriends Tora Doza over a flight simulator game. Kaz manages to download a copy of Captain Doza's agreement, but is spotted by Rucklin, who still bears a grudge against him for the loss of his racer. Kaz manages to hide from Captain Doza and Rucklin inside a closet, but discovers Doza's Imperial uniform, confirming that he once served the Galactic Empire. Tora helps Kaz escape, but the two narrowly avoid being incinerated in a trash incinerator. Following the misadventure, Tora grows curious about Kaz's true identity. So, what did you guys like from this episode, Dad?
I thought that one of the first things that I loved about this episode was when we saw the opening sequence Tora is playing the video game.
Yeah.
And it reminds me so much. Just a few weeks ago, before we moved back from California, we went to San Francisco to go to Lucasfilm, and you guys know all about that. We're not going to keep talking about that. But we went down to the arcade, the Penny Arcade, the antique games arcade at the Wharf there, and we played the original Star Wars video game that I would play as a kid, which is this game in Star Wars Resistance. The graphics and all that kind of reminded me of that. So I absolutely love that. And then, of course, we have the trash incinerator instead of the trash compactor. Felt like a throwback to A New Hope on that.
Can I throw something in there? Just like a quick interjection. Did you see Tora's moves? She was doing, like, backflips and, like, aerobatics and stuff. Like, she had training of some sort. Like, it was interesting.
Anyway. Yeah, maybe, I don't know, maybe she's a force user or something. I don't know.
I don't think I doubt that. But I just want to interject there.
Yeah. And then, of course, finding out that seeing Captain Doza's Imperial uniform. I mean, he's a captain, so I guess... Maybe that was what he was a captain in the Imperial Navy, maybe. He's an Empire guy. There's a story there. But he doesn't seem too excited about the First Order. So I think we're going to find out there's more there.
What about you, Nate?
Well, I enjoyed the episode just in general. It was a great episode and story was good. I did like Buggles.
Buggles.
Oh, Buggles. Why?
That droid. It reminds me a lot of K2SO. Yeah,
it does. I the story between Kaz and BBA, it's different between them. I feel like BBA doesn't feel like he's forced to be there, but I think he would rather be with Poe Dameron on his adventures. But I think BB-8's enjoying himself.
He's having fun.
No matter what. Other than that, I thought it was just an all-around good episode.
Okay. Yeah, there was one thing that I noticed that I really liked, and Kaz and Tora had just gotten out of the marketplace, you know, away from the growing mob, and Tora mentions that she has a flight simulator game, right?
Yeah.
I think she mentioned that she's been cooped up playing that game for a while. And Kaz goes, wait, you have flight simulator? And she's like, yeah, all three. And they're like, oh, let's go do that, right? So Tora runs off. And then Kaz turns to BB-8 and says, "This is it, Tora. This is our BB-8. This is our way to get into the tower." I was super impressed by that. That was an actual...
Hey, we finally had a spy moment
from him. He was doing some actually good spying, you know? And I was really... Like, finally, it's, you know, not only the episode before the winter finale that he's finally shown some brains in that respect. But I was really impressed by Kaz for that, you know? It was some actually good spying. And then, yeah, there was the Imperial uniform, and we got Rucklin. Rucklin again, which was interesting, and he's annoying. I wouldn't mind if we never saw him again, but and then there was Griff's lying,
that was
complaining.
Funny.
His voice, I noticed, you know, after having interviewed Stephen Stanton, Griff's voice is basically just Stephen's voice with a little rasp,
a little bit of raspy version of Stephen's voice, so
gravel to it. And,
yeah.
So what did you not like about this episode?
Trying to think back of anything I really didn't enjoy. It felt like, I guess, Tora's character in it, if I'm looking for something that's a criticism or a critique, I would say Tora kind of being held up in her room and just being, you know, not aware of what's going on and disobedient and of her dad and trying to sneak out and all that kind of stuff. I just didn't seem to pick up on that. I don't also understand the whole "are you a spy" thing. I mean, it just felt like, yeah, she saw that he snuck into her dad's room and knows he was in the closet and all that kind of stuff. But where did the leap come from to making it a spy?
She also said that she knows that he was a Republic pilot.
Yeah, that's true. I guess. Yeah.
But so, yeah.
Anyway, yeah.
What about you, Nate?
I didn't. Like I said, I haven't had any what's nots pop up quite yet. I'm waiting for it though. Every series has it, so I don't really have any criticisms about it. I thought it was just a good episode. It's a good series so far. So
I'd have to say, if I had one thing I didn't like, it would have to be Rucklin. I don't like his character. He's annoying. I've never liked characters like that in TV series where it's the annoying tattletale rival of the main protagonist. I never like those characters. They're just annoying. I just can't wait for the series to get rid of them. That's, you know, no offense against the character or even Elijah Wood, which is what I find cool that he
loves. We love Frodo Baggins.
Right. But I just don't like the character, you know, so I wouldn't mind if I never saw him again.
All righty then.
Anyway, so what do you think's next?
Yeah, I think that we have to find out what's going on with Doza. I think that's like a big part of where we're going with this. This is the big moment that like brings everything together, is Captain Doza's connection to the Empire. I think that now Kaz has to report that back to Poe, and that's going to lead to some things. And so, you know, that's what I predicted. I predict we're going to start seeing a lot more of this story of Captain Doza.
Well, I agree with you. I really do think we're going to see a lot more Captain Doza. I hope we do. But other than that, this wasn't much of a story episode other than finding out that Doza was an Imperial. I don't think we found much more from that. Except for Kaz finding out that the First Order is trying to make a deal with Mr. Doza.
Captain Doza. Yeah, I think what Steven said last week about the series to us really does apply. This first half of the first season, which obviously we'll be finishing up this weekend, is really just about getting all the chess pieces on the board and understanding what their place is. And now when the season renews, whenever that is, sometime in 2019, when it comes back the second half of the season, I think then we're going to find that all the pieces are where they need to be, and things are going to move very, very quickly. Steven seemed to suggest that as well.
Yeah. I think that, we're going to get more of Captain Doza. I don't think they reveal this right before the winter finale. I don't think that's a coincidence. I think they're going to leave us on a pretty big cliffhanger in regards to Captain Doza's previous alignment with the Empire. Also, I think that somewhere down the line, Tora is going to become, for lack of a better word, an informant for Kaz. I think she's going to eventually find out that Kaz is a spy, and I think that she's going to help him. Maybe we saw that she's got moves, for lack of a better term. Maybe she shows him a thing or two. how to, you know, actually stand up for himself, because he's, you know, we've seen he's not too adept at handling himself. But yeah, I think that's what's going to happen. That's my big prediction. So let's talk about next week's episode and what we know so far.
It's, and by the time you're listening to this, unless you're a Patreon supporter, you probably have already seen this episode, so there's no spoiler with this.
But it's Station Theta Black, right? Okay. It says, when Poe and Kaz find out an old First Order mining facility, BB-8 discovers the facility isn't so abandoned.
This is a big station, Poe. We're gonna get lost.
You worry too much. Worse things could happen.
Don't tell me.
Worse things just happened. The First Order's here.
Are all empty, Captain Phasma. Perhaps the intruders already left.
No. There are life signs moving to the upper levels.
Probably just scavengers, Captain.
I have no interest in your theories. Scour the upper floors. Find them. Spread out the explosives. I want this station completely destroyed.
What are they doing with all of those explosives?
You read it yourself. This place is slated for demolition. We're trying to get rid of any evidence of what they're doing down here. Now we have to find out what's going on.
To me, it seems like Kylo Ren's shuttle's on loan a lot.
Yeah, this Commander Pyre or whatever is using, and now Phasma is using that. Maybe it's not Kylo Ren's shuttle. Yeah. Maybe it's Phasma's shuttle.
Or just, because she was... That's right, she was at the raid. The only time we've seen... No, we've seen Kylo in the end of Last Jedi. With it in the shuttle, right?
I don't remember.
So it's not like crate, that's. Yeah. I thought the only time we had seen him was at the beginning of the Force Awakens.
He borrowed it from Phasma because she's dead now. it's hard to believe that.
I don't think she's dead.
I don't think she's dead either.
Some people.
She's been through some stuff.
Yeah, she's was given the Boba Fett treatment though. So
Boba Fett's not dead either. So
that's why both of them are likely dead. But anyway,
Predictions for this episode. I'll throw it to you, Nate.
Well, I think it's gonna be another. I'm excited to see Poe. I really am. He was great in the last Kowakian monkey lizard.
Yeah, episode. Those were great.
That was a great episode.
I can't do him. I'm tired. I can't do him today.
He was really good in that episode. I think that we're going to get a lot more action and a giant cliffhanger, like you were saying, Sam, for this episode. Do we know if this is an extended because it's the winter finale?
I don't know.
That's a good question.
That'd be great.
That would be awesome if we were to open up our Disney Now app on Sunday. Minutes. And it was 44 minutes instead
That'd
of 22.
Great. I would have really enjoyed that.
Oh, yeah.
But, you know, it may not be. It most likely isn't. But I am excited to see more Phasma after reading the Captain Phasma comics.
Okay.
I've found out that she's... You can tell that why that stormtrooper wouldn't have talked back to her any more than that. She won't let anybody see her without her mask on.
That's interesting.
And also, everybody thinks that she's a he as well.
Even though she talks?
The voice modulator is kind of a little weird. Everybody says...
Okay.
Sir, and that type of stuff.
Well, maybe they do that out of respect. Anyway, you know, one thing you said that she never wants people to see her with her mask off, right? I'm reading this this book on like the psychology of Star Wars, and it talks about masks and how when you're in a mask, it actually becomes easier to kill and to do things like that because there's anonymity behind it, and there's like no remorse. So that's probably another reason. Also, fear
that may play into a conversation maybe a little bit later. Yeah. All right.
And what about you, Dad? What are your predictions?
Big cliffhanger, resistance, First Order conflict. Kaz is going to be outed as being part of the resistance. Doza, we're going to find out he's going to have to choose between the First Order and the resistance. And I think that everything is going to begin to spiral out of control. And then the episode will be over and we'll have to wait.
And then big cliffhanger is Poe is going to get captured, and Kaz and BB-8 are going to have to save him.
Why not? All right.
All right.
What do you think?
I think we're going to see an awesome, yeah, like you said, Resistance First Order clip, because this is the first time we've seen, well, not the first, I mean, we've seen pilots battle First Order, but we haven't seen an infantry battle in this way. And we see Kaz in the clip, he actually has a blaster.
Yeah.
So maybe we see some more of that.
Maybe we'll see some of that military training.
Maybe. Well, we have a few clips that we haven't seen. From the original sneak peek preview of the
Resistance,
we do see a lot of different things of the Aces doing stuff that we haven't seen. I'm wondering if Kaz calls on the Aces for help from the First Order, and then.
But all that could be in the second half of the season too. So we'll have to find out on Sunday. And you probably already know as you listen to this podcast. So anyway, all right. So let's move to the next topic. Most Star Wars fans have resigned themselves to a Star Wars-less Christmas. But Santa may be leaving more than just coal in our stockings. Plus, giant bipedal green swine have been seen on the set of a Star Wars series.
Okay.
And it seems that Timothy Zahn really likes writing Thrawn trilogies. It's time for hot takes.
This is where the fun begins.
Well, you want the bad news? Are the really bad news.
Impressive. Every word in that sentence was wrong.
All right, so the first episode 9 footage is potentially coming this month. Have you guys seen this yet?
I've heard about it,
but I haven't seen or read anything about
it. Yeah, so production on Star Wars episode 9 kicked off this past summer with fans having to settle for leaked photos from the set to satiate. That's what? The word I was should read my stuff before I start reading it. To satiate our curiosities about the film, while it's an unconfirmed report, Collider, which we talked about earlier with Ken Napsok, claims that fans should get our first look at a teaser trailer for the film in the coming weeks. Steven Weintraub, for those of you that don't know, Steven Weintraub is the founder of Collider. His Twitter handle is Collider Frosty, and he's the one that selected us to be a part of the Last Jedi screening with Rian Johnson, where Turbis was officially accepted as the name of him.
Yes, officially.
Not canonized yet, but that'll happen. And he's usually pretty reliable when it comes to his tweets. He's not a speculator. He says, to those wondering, December is always, all caps, a huge month for new trailers. If you're a Disney fan, you can look forward to the first footage from Frozen 2 and a Star Wars, and he tagged them on it in the tweet, episode 9 this month. Would be shocked if both aren't revealed by December 25th.
Hmm.
Do you guys think we're going to get a trailer this month?
I don't think we get a trailer until after we find out the name.
Okay.
Good point. We don't have a name unless it's just going to be called episode 9, which would be...
I think what would be cool and different is they release the name with the teaser.
Yeah, so we're watching the teaser, and then we get to the end, and that's when the name is revealed.
Although, aren't usually the teasers released at Celebration the year before?
Well, let's go back in a little time machine. Go ahead, BB-8.
No, go ahead.
So, The Force Awakens' first teaser trailer was released in November 26th of 2014. Yeah. And then the next one was at Star Wars Celebration 2015. So there was one that was the first one we saw where everybody was talking about Rey's speeder thing looking like a creamsicle and all that. That one was, and we saw Finn. It opens with Finn.
Yeah,
remember, right, in the Stormtrooper costume. That one was released in November of 2014. And then the next one, the Chewie We're Home one we talked about earlier, that was in 2015 at Star Wars Celebration.
We were in Alabama when that release, weren't we? Mm. That's right.
Yeah. And then the Rogue One teasers. The first one was released in April of 2016. And the second one was released at Star Wars Celebration Europe 2016 in June. And then The Last Jedi first teaser trailer, as we three know so well, was first released at the Last Jedi panel at Star Wars Celebration Orlando in 2017.
So they kept doing different stuff.
Yeah. So are we getting a teaser, a name announcement, or either of these for Christmas?
I hope both of them, because, you know, I always want to see new Star Wars content.
Is there a big Star Wars movie being released this Christmas?
No.
Yeah.
Mary Poppins.
There's most speculation is they didn't want to do a Star Wars movie during Christmas this year because they didn't want it to conflict with that. Mm. But if they have a teaser trailer in front of Mary Poppins, guess what?
Lots of people.
The three of us going to see Mary Poppins, right?
Well, it'll be on the internet.
Yeah, but seeing it on the big screen.
We'll just go to spend, you know, $30 just to watch the trailer.
At least, right? You gotta get popcorn.
Yeah, so. I think that since there's not going to be a whole lot, there's not going to be a Star Wars film or anything recently, or soon, I think that definitely a name, no matter what. But most likely a teaser.
I predict that next weekend would have been the weekend of the release of a Star Wars movie. Remember, it was the 16th, and then mm-hmm. it was the 17th, mm-hmm. and all that kind of stuff. It's always that second full weekend of
December.
So I think it's next weekend. I think that they release something for all the fans as a little Christmas gift. So, all right, Gaborian guards. We're spotted on the Mandalorian set. You get it now?
Yeah, I was like, what?
My giant bipedal green swine. Yeah,
I was picturing like something really strange. Like, I was imagining a giant pig on like two like chicken legs. It was really strange.
Maybe that's some of the Ralph McQuarrie concept.
Yeah. Yes, I can see that now.
So the upcoming live-action TV series Star Wars The Mandalorian takes place between Star Wars Return of the Jedi and Star Wars The Force Awakens, which will allow characters and creatures from both the original and sequel trilogies to make appearances. A new report from the Hashtag Show claims that Gamorrean guards who helped protect Jabba's palace have been spotted on set. What do you guys think? Do we think that we can... Would it be cool to have some Gamorrean guards on there?
Wow. Well, I thought Luke killed them all, but I'm...
No, there's a species.
He didn't commit genocide.
Well, he killed...
No, that's Darth Vader, and that's his dad and his nephew. But yeah. Anyway.
Well, I mean, you know.
It's in the family.
We don't know what happens in between 6 and 7.
That's
he
true.
May have just gone full out on the Gamorrean species, you know, for whatever reason.
So random.
Impressive. Every word in that sentence was wrong.
Yeah.
I don't really care either way. I mean, it'd be cool to see some. Maybe that hints to a Jabba the Hutt thing, which we had speculated. No, we've speculated that Jabba... Jabba couldn't make an appearance because he's dead. Maybe a Hutt appearance of some sort or something to that effect. A crime family makes an appearance. I that wouldn't surprise me. As to the Gamorrean guards, I don't really care either way. They're cool.
It's not Jabba's palace anymore. It's going to be Salacious B. Crumb's palace.
Oh, are we changing this up?
Didn't he die?
Well, here's a little bit more news that we'll talk about with this idea. So our buddies over there at makingstarwars.net have also released photos of Jawas on the set.
Hmm.
And some are speculating that together, the Gamorrean guards and the Jawas reveal that the Mandalorian will be set on
Tatooine.
Now what do you think about that?
You had mentioned that as soon as you saw the first picture of the Mandalorian. You said, wow, that looks a lot like Tatooine. I immediately dismissed it. But yeah, with that, those creatures, I mean, I can't think of any other places where we've seen both together.
Yeah, and then there's also the element of, in the Aftermath trilogy by Chuck Wendig, there's these interludes, and there's a specific interlude of a character on Tatooine purchasing Mandalorian armor called Cobb Van. I can't remember his name. I'll look it up sometime. But look it up. You can just Google it. Aftermath, Tatooine, Mandalorian. Wendig, it'll pull it up. I can't remember the name. So I think that character is the character that we're seeing in The Mandalorian. So
yeah. You had mentioned maybe that's Boba Fett. I looked at his armor. I don't see Boba Fett's armor.
He purchases armor from someone after Boba Fett's death. It's potentially like parts of his armor. Or,
or it may not be Boba Fett's armor at all. It just said Mandalorian armor,
yep,
right?
It is. Yep.
That makes sense. I can see that now.
Next topic, it's treason, then. Mm. Thrawn is coming back for a third novel. Lucasfilm and Delray are pleased to announce the title of the next installment in Timothy Zahn's best-selling Thrawn series, Star Wars Thrawn Treason. Set in the time of the Empire, here's the official description of the new novel.
Ooh. All
right, you ready for this?
I'm ready.
You ready, BB Nate?
Mm-hmm.
Grand Admiral Thrawn faces the ultimate test of his loyalty to the Empire in this epic Star Wars novel from best-selling author Timothy Zahn. If I were to serve the Empire, you would command my allegiance. That's me trying to pretend
That's
to be...
That's horrible.
Yeah, I'm not very good at that. Such was the promise Grand Admiral Thrawn made to Emperor Palpatine at their first meeting. Since then, Thrawn has been one of the Empire's most effective instruments, pursuing its enemies to the very edges of the known galaxy. But as keen a weapon as Thrawn has become, the Emperor dreams of something far more destructive. Now, as Thrawn's TIE Defender program is halted in favor of Director Krennic's secret Death Star project, he realizes that the balance of power in the Empire is measured by more than just military acumen or tactical efficiency. Even the greatest intellect can hardly compete with the power to annihilate entire planets. As Thrawn works to secure his place in the Imperial hierarchy, his former protege, Eli Vanto, returns with a dire warning about Thrawn's homeworld. Thrawn's mastery of strategy must guide him through an impossible choice: duty to the Chiss Ascendancy or fealty to the Empire he has sworn to serve, even if the right choice means committing treason. Star Wars Thrawn will be Thrawn Treason will be released for pre-order next week and arriving on shelves in the summer of 2019. Samuel the Hutt, you're a huge fan of the Thrawn novels.
I am.
What you thinking?
I can't wait for summer 2019. you mentioned Eli Vanto. We didn't hear anything about him in
Not
Alliances.
Not at all in Alliances. Yeah.
Anyway, towards the end of the book, well, I guess it was more of a theme throughout the entire book, Vader is questioning Thrawn's alliance.
His loyalty
to the Empire. I mean, the whole time. Because they were dealing with Chiss stuff, or Chiss things. It was Chiss children that they were trying to save.
Yeah, Chiss children that are force sensitive that were called among the Chiss Skywalkers. What?
Yeah, anyway. You gotta read the book. It's, yeah.
I listened to it like Dad and I did during a 16-hour long road trip.
Yeah, it was awesome.
I'm super excited. Are we going to see more Emperor in this, you think?
I don't know.
Maybe he gets in on some of the action?
Do you... Well, let's get your first... Before I ask this question, we'll get your opinion, BB Nate.
I was expecting a book to be announced from Del Rey that whole day. I saw that on Twitter. He kept releasing... Del Rey released a...
Del Rey's the publishing company. Mm-hmm. Okay.
And they released a GIF with no context of just Palpatine saying it's treason then. Nothing. And then, a few hours later, they also released Krennic saying, "We stand amongst my achievement and not yours." And so I kept seeing on the Tumbling Saber group that they're like,
on the Facebook group for Tumbling Saber?
Okay. They're like, "Okay, Delray, stop. What are you trying to do?" And I'm like, "They're releasing something today."
That's cool.
And then I see Thrawn Treason and I'm like, "There we go."
That's awesome. So here's the challenge, because the name is called Treason. Do you think that Grand Admiral Thrawn is going to be able to get away with treason against the Empire when it comes to Palpatine and all that?
Well, you don't get it. He can't be tried for treason if he's never caught. So he would obviously get away with it, so it can't be called treason.
Well, that's an interesting
thought. Well, he's going back to the Empire. He has to.
Explain. This is where I was going.
Yeah, well, the problem is he has to go back to the Empire to, first of all, finish off the Rebels, and second of all,
right,
he has to get lost with Ezra, and we
exactly.
can't yeah. see that.
That's true.
So maybe the treason ends up being against the Chiss Ascendancy and not against the Empire.
Or maybe he just...
That's gotta be tough.
Yeah, I think it's gonna be... I'm like getting chills just thinking about this book, so that's awesome. All right, let's get to our main topic. I mean, we've only been talking for like an hour and 15 minutes, and we haven't even got to the main topic. Kylo Ren took out all his anger and hatred for Supreme Leader Snoke on his helmet, leaving it in pieces on a turbo lift. But now... Bless you.
Sorry, I was trying to hold it in before the intro. All right, but
can we try that again? He would look like his head was about to explode.
I was literally trying so hard. I'm like, I need to get this sneeze out.
All right, let's try this again. Kylo Ren took out all his anger and hatred for Supreme Leader Smoke. Oh man, we just
let's try this again.
Oh, third time's a charm.
Just do it in your, you know,
in my game show host voice. Okay, it'll help me. Mm-hmm. You think? Okay, Kylo Ren took out all his anger and hatred for Supreme Leader Snoke on his helmet, leaving it in pieces on a turbo lift. But now there's a rumor that Ren will be donning it again in episode 9. Is that a good idea? Let's discuss it.
Rebellions are built on hope.
If you live long enough, you see the same eyes in different people.
I find your lack of faith disturbing.
All right, according to our friends at MakingStarWars.net, sources have said they saw Kylo Ren with the reforged mask on... Okay, hold on. Just 1 second. Spoiler alert. All right, this is a little spoiler. All the podcasts are talking about it. It's all over the internet. But if you're freaking out about it, just, you know, you can turn the episode off, go to Twitter, find our Twitter poll, make sure you sign up to be a Patreon supporter, because we love you guys for doing that, and give us ratings and reviews.
Rate us 5 stars.
Yeah, and you can just turn it off. You've already listened for like an hour and a half, or no, hour and 15 minutes. So thank you so much for your listening. But I think this is worth listening to, so keep going. All right. According to our friends at MakingStarWars.net, sources have said that they saw Kylo Ren with the reforged mask on in various stages of dress. Hopefully he had a cowl or something on. which also means we can't yet say how often he wears the helmet. So if this is directly from the Making Star Wars report. So if this news disappoints you, try to keep that in mind. Here's where it gets interesting. To them, it looked like the mask was pieced together using some kind of red crystalline bonding material. The visual gave the mask a very corrupted look. A little Kylo, a little Vader, and maybe even a hint of Maul's facial stylings. First, what do you think? Is Kylo bringing the mask back? Samuel the Hutt.
Yes.
You think he's bringing it back? Okay. Just a yes or no?
Yeah, I mean, with the other questions, I think that I can explain my
okay. So maybe the initial reaction. Yes. They're bringing the mask back.
No.
Your initial reaction is no. So we have a conflict here. I say yes. All right, so let's talk about this. What did you guys think about the description of the mask? So let's talk about this. So it says, again, just to reiterate, it looked like it was pieced back together with some kind of red crystalline bonding material. It gave the mask a very corrupted look, something a little bit like Kylo, a little bit like Vader, and maybe even had a hint of Maul's facial stylings, and Sam has been, like, itching to say something. So go.
So the red crystalline bonding material... Maybe he pieces it while he's up at Crate.
Yeah, maybe. I don't know.
Anyway, as for the description, I'm trying to get a visual of that in my head, and it looks awesome. And you said that it looks a little like Kylo, a little like Vader, and a little bit of Maul. Where's the Emperor in this? You know, you would think that it would have maybe a little bit of the Emperor. So I'm thinking of the description in my head, and I'm looking at the red, and it almost looks like... The red crystalline bonding metal almost looks like lightning on the mask, almost.
In my
visual of what the mask would look like, it almost looks like the red could be like lightning or something. I don't know.
Do you think it's cool?
I love it. The corrupted look. I want to see Maul. Kylo back in the mask. You know, that was one of the things that I loved about Maul. I'm having a tough time.
Kylo
in The Force Awakens. And when, you know, Han says, take that mask off, you don't need it. I was worried. Well, no, we got to backtrack here. We've already seen with it off. But anyway, when he's interrogating Rey, you know, I was worried at first. Like, maybe his face is all messed up or something. Because usually when you see someone with a mask on, especially a dark side force user, they're pretty messed up under the mask. I'm hoping to see the mask again, because it's freaky. You know, you think of Darth Vader, what do you think of the mask? You know, it's so iconic. So I want to see Kylo with it again, especially this corrupted helmet.
What do you think,
BB-8? I mean, I think the idea is cool. I don't think I want it. I really don't think that it's a great idea for it. And
why? Explain why.
Well...
So you like the idea of, like, you like the description. You think that's a cool description. But the whole idea of Kylo Ren taking the mask back on, you don't like.
I don't care if he changes his headwear. I don't care what he does. It wouldn't affect it. I just think that, I think Rey would have less fear, I wouldn't say. Less fear in Kylo if he put the mask back on. She doesn't like him with it on, and she doesn't... A monster behind the mask.
She'd have less fear?
Yes.
With the mask on?
I think she's afraid of the fact that Ben can be redeemed, especially with the mask off. She can see all of his facial reactions. And she knows when he is afraid, or he's sad, or happy, or something like that. She knows when he's vulnerable with a mask on. I think she just knows that at any point she can take anything, so.
And that kind of goes back to what I was saying before. I was reading that Star Wars psychology book, and another reason why a lot of stormtroopers and a lot of characters are masked is it's easier to excuse killing them. You know, you don't, there's not an emotional connection that's built with them. You know, you'll see that most protagonists are unmasked. You bond a connection. You there's a connection with them. Stormtroopers, though, they're disposable. There's no mask, so you can't see their facial reactions. You can't form an emotional bond with them. So it's easier to excuse killing them off. So what you were saying is it would be more difficult for Rey to kill Kylo with the mask off because there's a human under there. You know, it adds personality and character.
And she's grown a connection with him.
So if he puts a mask back on, it psychologically, yeah, it would be easier for her to kill him. I just thought that was interesting. But
so, you know, Nathan explained it, and I think you said you'd like the idea, but explain a little bit more why you like the idea of Kylo Ren taking the mask back.
Well, I think it just makes sense, you know? I think that it was explained that he wore the mask in the first place to have some reputation and induce some fear into the members of the First Order, right? It's, you know, it's intimidating to see that guy in a mask. So I think now that he's the supreme leader of the First Order now, I think that it makes sense for him to don the mask again. It adds that a fear factor, kind of gets everyone back in line, shows him that, hey, I'm the boss. I think it just makes sense that he puts the mask back on.
Well, it seems like Kylo Ren really likes tradition of the Sith and really wants to be like all the other Siths. If you think leaders and, like, let's say supreme leaders have never worn a mask. Palpatine didn't wear a mask. Snoke didn't wear a mask. Sidious didn't wear a mask. So all the leaders in the Sith have never worn a mask, so...
True, but Palpatine did sort of hide behind a mask. You know, his hood most of the time covered up his face. But for the people of the Empire, they never actually saw his normal face. He hid behind a mask of his old self. As for Maul...
Maul never wore a mask.
Yeah, no, there's no way I can spin that one. But most...
Supreme Leader Snoke.
No. But... We don't know if he has...
But Snoke wasn't a Sith.
Right.
They've established that he wasn't Sith.
You know, Kylo's trying to be like Vader, which is a Sith.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, it's interesting because the very first trailer that we ever saw... it wasn't the first trailer. It was the second trailer, I believe, for The Last Jedi, is when we see him destroy the mask. Did we see a picture of that? We did see a picture of that at the first trailer. We see the mask...
Yep.
On the ground. That's in the very first trailer that we saw at Celebration in Orlando in 2017. The idea of the mask being destroyed is a central theme to The Last Jedi. It's a big part of it. It's interesting, you brought up something, I think it was you, Nathan, a few minutes ago as we were talking about Han Solo, was it? I'm not sure which one of you brought it up, but Han Solo told him to take the mask off.
Yeah, I said that.
You said that, Sam. Yeah. Okay. So we see that first moment in The Force Awakens, he removes it for Rey. And in that moment, she even talks about, what's the line, the first thing that she says to him?
She says,
you're hiding behind a mask or something.
He says, you still want to kill me. And she's like, that's what happens when you're being hunted by a creature in a mask.
Yeah. So there's this mask theme that's like really a big deal in this movie.
Especially
these movies. First thing Rey says, it really, to Kylo Ren, is about his mask. Han, the first thing that Han says is, take off that mask. You don't need it. Mm-hmm. Right? And then we have, of course, Snoke. He says, take that ridiculous thing off. So this idea of Ren, of Kylo Ren wearing a mask and being confronted by that is central in this. So he's taken it off. He's destroyed it at this point. Why do you think he would put it back on?
Well, each sentence that he said, all of them want to take his mask off. I think his tipping point was when Snoke said it. I think he destroyed his mask for a reason. I don't think he destroyed his mask as a symbolic thing of, oh, yes, I'm going to bring my mask back. I'm planning on that. But, yes, it may have turned him over once he killed Snoke. He may want his mask back. I don't know. I don't care. I'm just saying that they've all told him to take his mask off. And when he destroyed it, I don't think he's going to go back from getting another mask. I think that he's now focused on being the supreme leader and not worrying about what he wears on his head.
I think that it could be a sign of total rebellion. He's killed Snoke. He doesn't care about Rey anymore. He's killed his father. I think he's like...
So he's a part of the rebellion? I mean, he did say that the rebellion...
No. He's just... the idea that Sam's talking about is he's going to do whatever he wants to do and nobody's going to stop
him. Right. But I one thing I want to mention is I don't think he does it if he's going light side. I think that if you see him don the mask earlier in the story, it's probably... Well, I guess they could do it either way. It could be meaning that he's gone full dark side and there's no chance of redemption. Or it's a way to make it more dramatic when he is redeemed. You know, we've seen him wear the mask and that's a dark side user, a Sith icon, is to wear a mask. So if we see him early on in the movie wearing a mask, we're usually going to immediately think, okay, I guess he's gone full dark side. So when he is redeemed, it may have more of an impact.
I think that if he does wear the mask, if this report from Making Star Wars, and this, you know, this isn't express.co.uk, makingstarwars.net has very credible source for this type of stuff. I think that we're going to see the mask, and I think that it's a symbol that he is conflicted. He's hiding behind this mask to try to make himself feel more powerful. I think we're seeing him piece this mask together. I think it's going to be a part of the mask that was on that he had in The Force Awakens in the beginning of The Last Jedi that he destroyed in the turbo lift. I think it's going to be a portion of that mask, and I think it's going to be a portion of Vader's mask. Mm. And I think he's going to find a way to mix it all together. He's going to, it's a combination of him trying to become Vader, which is his whole goal. He's trying to prove to himself that he's evil. He's fighting against the light. That's the whole conversation with Han Solo in The Force Awakens. He kills his own father in an attempt to overcome the light that's in him. Rey senses the light in him in all of these scenes. I think that the mask is a symbol of him trying to be this evil being that he doesn't really, he's not completely. And so every time he puts on the mask, it's like a Jekyll and Hyde thing. I think when we get to episode 9, that when we see Kylo Ren wearing the mask, he is full on evil, fully given over to the dark side. And he is doing that in order to bring terror to the galaxy. And then when we see him take that mask off, when that mask is gone, he's flipping back. It's Kylo Ren versus Ben Solo. And Kylo Ren will be wearing the mask and Ben Solo will be taking the mask off. That's what I think is going to happen in this. Thoughts?
Yeah, okay. I mean, I don't really care what it means, to be honest. Either way, I just want to see the mask because its description sounds awesome. I'm sure there's going to be like a...
You think I'll see it in the trailer if we see a trailer this month? Do you think that they'll do that? Do you think that they'll give fans a year to process the reality that the mask is back? Because there's a lot of people that are really upset about this idea.
Mm. I'm hoping that they come out with a Black Series mask. You know how like they do with those one with Vader.
Get the mask started to sell before Celebration.
like they've had a regular Kylo Ren one. I want to see this corrupted Kylo Ren mask.
Yeah,
that'd be cool. Fun. Anyway.
Well, I think that it is good, just not for the mask. I feel like it would be great if they just released the trailer this month.
Yeah,
just for the theories and speculations, especially with his mask. I feel like it could totally mean if it's called, even if they sell toys and they call it a corrupted Kylo Ren. People usually use names from toys to base their theories on, and if it's corrupted Kylo Ren, and then people are probably thinking he is full dark side and he is corrupted. So
you at the beginning said BB Nate, you said no, he's not going to wear the mask. You still stand by that position?
I'm neutral. I don't care if he does or doesn't. I mean, if I don't really feel like a mask plays into the story too heavily, unless they explain it somehow, and I just get totally blown away.
No, I think the mask would have to play heavily into it. But what about you, Sam?
Yeah, I still stand by that he's going to wear one. I think that it just makes sense.
Alrighty. Well, in the immortal words of Kylo Ren.
Anything else?
Who's going first? Should I have that one too?
Right. So the Millennium Falcon has landed at Galaxy's Edge in Disneyland.
Yeah, that's pretty awesome. This guy flew a helicopter over it and took a picture of the Millennium
Falcon.
It looks absolutely amazing.
When it opens.
Do we need to like start booking tickets now and getting in line?
I don't know.
We should probably go ahead and just get in line right now.
We're going to be like lined up out there and the employees are going to be like, what are you doing? We're waiting for the Millennium Falcon.
Right? Yeah.
You know that's coming out in like a year, right? Marvel has announced a new Vader Dark Visions limited series.
Yeah, did you guys see the cover art for that thing?
I did, and I think it's a really cool concept.
Yeah, he's got a Vader on a horse.
Yeah.
Oh, that's right.
With the Galactic Empire shield.
I think it's
lightsaber.
Remember the summary correctly, I think it's like he goes to the Outer Rims and starts like using his Sith powers and like doing
more Outer Rim and Unknown Regions type stuff. Here's the other thing that's really interesting, and that actually ties into exactly what my theory is right now. I asked on Twitter earlier tonight because I hadn't think of it. Nobody seems to come up with it. There are no space horses in Star Wars movies.
Yeah.
But there's a horse.
No, there's
not. There's a horse in this cover, and there's a horse in the leaked photos from Episode 9. There's horses in it.
What about the Fathiers?
They're not horses.
They're...
I'm looking at, like, horses. Oh. This was a horse on the cover. These are horses on the leaked set photos from Episode 9. I wonder if they're in the Outer Rim and there's a connection. There's all of this stuff coming back.
They can
fly. And lastly, rumor, Episode 9 might feature Lando's daughter. That would be cool.
Okay.
Whoa!
All right, so let's talk about this week's podcast poll of the week. Since we talked about it, we're just going to jump into the fray again. Let everybody comment all they want on this topic. Should Kylo Ren wear his mask again in Episode 9? We're going to give you four chances. Yes, no, absolutely not. Since some of you are so adamant against this, we want to give you that option. And then unsure, comment below. So that'll be cool. Thank you guys so much for listening. Please on iTunes, Stitcher, Podbean, whatever they are. Castbox, I think, is one. Anchor, Spreaker, Block Talk Radio, whatever you listen to us on.
Pandora.
Pandora. Well, we haven't gotten on Pandora yet, but that's a new service that we're working on trying to get on. Please give us your ratings. Please give us your reviews. They are our oxygen. If you're not following us on Twitter, you are missing out. I'm not saying that because I'm trying to be proud about us. I'm talking about the amazing people that comment on our posts and the interactions that are going on and the discussions that are happening there. If you're not following us on Twitter, you need to. If you don't have a Twitter account, just go sign up and follow us on Twitter so that we can do that. Instagram, we're trying to get that ramped up a little bit more even. It's just hard because we don't, take photos of ourselves a lot. And that's what Instagram seems to be about. Lastly, Patreon. Please, 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 please sign up to be a Patreon supporter. $1 a month gets you in the contest that we're doing this month. We're going to give all our new Patreon supporters for December and those that increase their support as well. On Patreon, we're going to put you in a drawing for a Turbis the Pork mug. We've got stickers that are on the way. They're special Christmas gifts to all of you that should be coming in the next couple of weeks. We've got some amazing things happening in January. You don't want to miss out on those, including our Resistance, our Star Wars Rebels Revisited YouTube and podcast that will be coming out, our special Patreon only Star Wars series on the themes of Star Wars. Hope is there January. If you're a $10 a month Patreon supporter, you get our sticker of the month club. If you're a $50 a month supporter, you're part of all of the things before it, as well as our t-shirt of the month club, and we want you guys to be a part of that. So go to patreon.com/Tatooine Sons, please. And support family-friendly podcasting. Star Wars podcasting. All right. I guess that's pretty much it. Anything else you guys want to say?
May the Force be with you.
May the Force be with you.
May the Force be with you. And I did not cut that audio, so I'll get that ready for next week.
This party's over.
I like that Wookiee.
Don't get technical with me.
Droid, please.